One, two, three, not only you and me, got 180 degrees and I'm caught in between. Counting 1, 2, 3, feet apart and back free, getting down with 3 feet, everybody loves old Kevin.
Just a little precursor to get you in the mood for studying, and now here's where the other lecture left off for you. Enjoy!
The males have longer beaks and the females have shorter beaks. This is because they're on the island, so it's harder for resources to come in, there's not places to go, so the males have these longer beaks, longer tongues. And keep in mind, woodpeckers get their food from in trees, getting insects in trees. So the males are able to reach farther into the trees, and the females can eat things closer to the surface. And this allows the males and the females to coexist on the island, have enough of them, so they can eat different things, and they spend their time differently. Males will be probing and pecking, and females will be searching, they won't do as much probing because they don't have these long tongues. Now on the mainland, they're about the same size because these birds can only spread out, there's more resources, they're not on a confined island. So this is just one example of one species of bird that evolved in two different ways, one because there was interspecific competition and one because there wasn't as much. So, let's see where that leads us. Okay. So, summary of these woodpeckers is that they're a good example of ghost competition of the past, because of past competition, they've evolved these longer tongues and such. So, over evolutionary time, it was competition that shaped these characteristics through natural selection. Okay, so the males with the longer tongues lived, because they eat different food than the females. The females with shorter beaks lived, too. So that's how we ended up with them. The males and females are more divergent on the islands, as indicated by tongue lengths and behaviors. Resources are in shorter supply on islands, therefore competition is more intense, which can be manifested by divergent male and female characteristics, which permits coexistence of both sexes on the islands. This is an example of the effects of interspecific competition over time. Character displacement is a change in physical characteristic as a result of competition. So, a character displacement of the woodpeckers would be their tongue length, because that was changed. It's a physical characteristic, and it was changed as a result of competition. Character displacement. Some other methods of reducing interspecific competition is territoriality. So one group of individuals will have one section to themselves, and another will have another section to themselves. A prolonged breeding season, like in frogs, can decrease the need for competition. Increasing the breeding season allows more individuals to eat more at certain times while they're trying to breed. The males can get around more. Things like that. The dispersal of male or female offspring, like male cheetahs or female African wild dogs, after they're grown enough to take care of themselves, will travel away from their mother / herd, and that way they won't have to compete with their parents for resources. Usually males, if they disperse, they disperse farther and wider. So they're more likely to get away. Like we said, interspecific competition is a density-dependent factor. One of the major effects of interspecific competition is to regulate population growth. Like we said, affluence increases with increasing population density. You know, that's the same thing as disease. Disease is an density-dependent factor. So the closer you are in contact with one another, greater population density, the more likely you are to spread these diseases. So we have to look at population growth patterns to understand the role of intraspecific competition. So you have exponential curves and logistic curves. Exponential growth is exhibited by humans, where the more kids we have, the more kids they have, we're just growing and growing and growing at an ever-increasing rate. However, with most organisms, we see a logistic growth pattern, which is also called sigmoidal. Okay, so an exponential growth curve means population is increasing at an ever-increasing rate, which is common to all organisms. All organisms at some time or another experience exponential growth, but usually it only lasts for a relatively short period of time. Humans are the exception to that. So we keep going exponentially because we keep using our resources more than we actually have them. So it's like our population is doubling every 10 years, basically. So the equation for exponential growth is the change in number of individuals over the change in time, which equals the per capita rate of increase times the number of individuals. Yeah. So the rate of change is on the left. That equals the per capita rate of increase times the number of individuals. And that can vary with every species. So, okay, so with sigmoidal population growth, at first, your population grows rapidly, possibly exponentially. And then, eventually, your growth slows. You become low on resources, intraspecific competition is probably kicking in, if your population is getting denser and denser. And then, eventually, you will reach carrying capacity, which is where your growth rate stops. Your population size stabilizes, and this is at carrying capacity, which we call K. So K is the capacity of the environment to support a certain number of individuals. So the environment will only allow so many individuals to live because of its limited resources, etc. Now K is controlled by density-dependent factors, which are more important as the population grows. So disease, resources available, intraspecific competition, all these affect K, which is your carrying capacity. Alright, then we've got an example with paramecium. We got some more equations. Alright, so with a logistic growth pattern, the equation is a little different. So on the left, we still have your rate of change, which is this change in numbers over the change in time. Then on the right, instead of just the number of individuals times the per capita increase, you have the per capita rate of increase times the number of individuals times 1 minus the number of individuals over carrying capacity. So when there's no change, that makes 1 minus 1, which is 0, which means your rate of change is 0. With an exponential curve, there is no chance that it's going to be 0 because your per capita rate of increase will probably not be 0 and the number of individuals will probably not be 0. However, with your logistic growth curve, 0 is very possible if the number of individuals equals the carrying capacity, which means you can't fit any more, so only the ones that die will be replaced. So you're still reproducing, but your birth rate equals your death rate. Okay, so the logistic curve depicts a leveling off of the population at K. And K is the number of individuals capable of being supported by the environment. And intraspecific competition is a major influence on K's value. So, in summation, carrying capacity controls your realized niche and is a density-dependent factor, so it influences K, because K is influenced by density-dependent factors. Let's remember. Okay? And that is all for intraspecific competition. Thank you for listening. Sorry that was 25 minutes. I will try to supplement with pictures now. Have a good life.
One, two, three, not only you and me, got 180 degrees and I'm caught in between.